Just by way of background, I spent 15 years as finance director at West Ham, so that's my sort of background in football. I left about 3 years ago, and since then I've been doing a lot of consultancy work, not least with Supporters Direct, and I've assisted some other trusts in a similar situation to yourselves. So, you know, we've been down this road a few times. As I think you know, the trust and the club entered into a confidentiality agreement, which meant the club gave us access to a lot of financial information, which I've been through. I've given a report to the trust board. Because it was a confidentiality agreement, I'm afraid I can't go into a lot of detail, none of us can, about what we've had access to. James has talked about the document that will come out shortly. We would expect to be able to be a lot more open with you there, but we would have to get clearance. So I'd apologise in advance if we can't give you straight answers to all of your questions. But the information I have produced here is based partly on what I've been able to obtain through this exercise, and partly also from my own experience in football down the years. Looking at this slide, you know, a lot of clubs, especially in the upper echelons of English and Welsh football, are probably not run sustainably. There's a growing dependence on apparently rich benefactors, but it's quite possible for clubs to be successful and be run sustainably. And in my view, there's a lot to be said for it, because firstly, all benefactors aren't always as rich as they seem. And for any of you who know the history of West Ham and the Icelanders, you'll perhaps understand where I'm coming from there. But it can also encourage lazy decision making. You know, you have the choice of, do you bring lads up from the academy and coach them and make them better footballers, or do you go to the owner and say, look, just give us another 100,000 for another player all the while? And I think it can make clubs lazy. They don't necessarily perform at their best when they know there's a sugar daddy there who's going to bail them out all the time. I tried to list some of the things I think are important. When I say a consistent philosophy, I think if a club's got a clear idea on the style of play, on the player recruitment, it's going to choose a manager that's going to deliver that style. You may be focused on the youth academy bringing players through. I think if you adopt a consistent approach here and pay dividends, if you're chopping and changing all the while, it's not going to be successful. What's absolutely vital is decision making. We've all got limited budgets. You have to spend it wisely. You have to do your research, and you have to make good decisions on player recruitment. The lower points, governance, transparency, I think some of the others are going to talk about, but I think it's evident that it has to make sense. Can we move on to the next one, Gavin? Yeah, realistic budgeting is being sensible, doing something that's achievable. Recruitment, I've touched on before, there's got to be a budget, we've got to adhere to it. If the budget is £1 million, you can't blow half of it on one player. You've got to have a structure, you need 10 players, you've got to make sure you've got enough to sign 10 players. You can't blow all on the first two or three. Approval procedures and cost control is so important. You know, the more that you eliminate waste, the more you're going to have to invest in the squad. It's basic common sense in any business, but it's more important than ever, I think, in football, because it's too easy to make bad decisions, and you then repent at leisure if you've invested unwisely. And cash flow, I think, is vital. A lot of clubs, you're in a lucky position, I think, or apparently lucky, where you get a lot of money up front, and clubs start asking for their season ticket money, so earlier and earlier, I've seen clubs collecting next year's season ticket money in February and March. They needed to pay the bills in March and April, so they spent half of next season's money before this season is finished. And you get into this sort of vicious circle where you're always spending next year's money, and it's very hard to break out of it. So I think it's vital that the club knows where it's going, it's got the cash flow under control, and it hasn't got that dependency. Because you end up discounting season tickets, and you may be giving away 15 or 20,000 in discounts every year just to get the money in early, which in the scheme of things is counterproductive, I think. Yeah, this is about as much information as I can disclose on the finances, but this is all information from the public domain. Smallish companies like Newport County are not obliged to disclose that much in their accounts. These are summary figures from a balance sheet. There's no obligation whatsoever to disclose any of the trading results, but we can glean some things from just comparing year on year. A lot of you aren't going to be as interested as I am in accounts, but I think you probably all understand that if a business has net liabilities, that means what it owes, its liabilities are greater than its assets, and that's not a good thing. The club had a deficit for each of those years, and believe me, I've seen earlier accounts, it has had for many years. It's spending more than it earns. The figures in the bottom half, the share capital is the amount of money invested by shareholders over the years. This is all done in round thousands, so up to 1.7 million at the end of June 2014. That's a year and a bit ago. These aren't last year's figures, they aren't available yet. These are a year and more old. The profit and loss figures, 2.17 million, then that is accumulated losses over the 26 years of the company, 25 years of the company's existence. It's made accumulated losses of well over 2 million in that time. What we can tell for that year, which is your first year back in the league, you lost £570,000 in that year. Notwithstanding that, share capital, £700,000 was invested in the company in that year, and the current and long-term liabilities went up by about £160,000, so those were new loans and the like invested in the company. So loans and share capital, about £800,000 or £900,000 was put into the club, partly to subsidise losses of £570,000, partly also to invest in some fixed assets, which was going to be equipment, maybe some property. I'm afraid I don't have details on what that is, but quite a significant sum, obviously. I also know that the club lost money in the promotion season, no doubt helped to get promoted, and the £570,000 loss in the year just ended, in the year 2014, we'll see in the next slide, if you can move on. I have had access to more detailed information, but as I explained, because of the confidentiality agreement, I can't really divulge a great deal of detail. But following promotion, the turnover, the income almost doubled. You get access to football league distributions. I guess the gate money went up, the commercial money no doubt went up, but it was all spent, more than all spent. Player wages were 70% of that turnover figure. At the end of it all, substantial loss of more than £500,000, and as I explained in the earlier slide, largely funded by new loans and by new investment in share capital. Moving on, please, Kevin. So, a very sort of high-level look at the year just ended. Again, I've had access to some information. It was incomplete, but this much I am able to be pretty confident about. The pattern of club losing money has continued. Substantial losses, I would say. Match day income turned off, despite the fact that you guys moved up from 14th to 9th, the small reduction in average attendance is, I think, about 7%. Inevitably, that was funded by very financial support, principally from Les Scanning, but some of the other directors too. And my estimate, I've not seen exact figures, but I think loss is in excess of £500,000. Tremendous that you finished 9th, narrowly missed out on the playoffs. But you know, it's clear that this sort of financial performance is not really sustainable unless there's going to be a constant injection of $500 million a year, which I don't think it's realistic to expect, certainly not under trust ownership. This is, I think, interesting information which I've obtained from Football League documents, not in the public domain, but it's distributed to all clubs in the league. As I think many of you will know, that there's a sort of new initiative came in some years ago where they're trying to control salary costs, in particular at all levels of the Football League. And just as a guide to clubs, the league then produces a report based on the information that clubs submit. And it's quite interesting. It doesn't name the clubs, but you know, we can all guess who's probably going to be the club earning $5.3 million in income, didn't get promoted. And the smallest club, who I think stayed in the league, $1.2 million turnover. Massive difference. I'll explain his football fortune in coming a minute. And again, a massive difference in the highest and lowest player wage figures. I've shown what the average is for all clubs, and I've shown where Newport ranks. So 20th highest turnover, 10th highest player wages. And it's interesting that there's a massive correlation between the wages and where we finished in the league, 9th against 10th. But you can also see that that turnover was not funding those wages. The wages we were obviously benefiting from investment. This football fortune figure is something that's disclosed separately in the Football League report, and it's exceptional income. It's things like transfer fee income, prize money from cup runs, and also investment from benefactors. So, not massive figures. I was surprised. I thought we might see that some clubs are getting $1 million pumped in, but it doesn't look like it's that massive. I think there were 6 clubs had nothing whatsoever by way of football fortune income. The biggest was 400 and the average was 140. We're probably not going to enjoy very much from benefactors in the future, but you know, we might get the odd cut run, we might get the odd transfer fee. Not something we can bank on. But I think this tells us that even if we don't get it, it doesn't mean we can't compete. We might not get it consistently, but every few years we might get a small amount which will help. Moving on again, please. I've seen a draft forecast for next year produced by the club. Needs refining, needs a lot more work, and I think I would recommend to the trust that, and all of this will be happening in parallel when we're doing the offer document, it needs a bit more research done by ourselves to get confidence that it's reliable. They're expecting that match income will be stable after the drop last year. They're expecting an increase in commercial and retail income. Now, by, say, mid-August, there should be a good feel for the commercial income because your sponsor will be in place, advertisers should be in place. It should be possible to verify whether that's achievable. We know that the Football League is distributing more money. We've seen correspondence, so that's going to happen, and that's great news. They're budgeting for a significant reduction in the player wage budget, but they're recruiting at the moment, so those figures should be pretty certain in the very near future, and we should be able to say with confidence that they've hit the budget and hopefully not exceeded it. I've seen the staff wage figure broken down in some detail by name and by role, so again, that's achievable. And they're budgeting for a small trading profit. As I say, all of this can be researched, and it will be in the very near future. There is scope, obviously, for upside from cut runs. There's got to be a massive focus on cost savings, cost controls, and that is something that I'm sure the trust will be very focused on if they're successful in gaining control. Which is the next slide, and is obviously the critical one. The costs I've summarised, I would stress that We're still verifying some of these figures, and there's negotiations to be done. People are owed money, but the trust would want to sit down with all of them and negotiate what these creditors will accept, which may not be paid in full, and that's going to be a process that continues throughout the next month. My estimate, and it's no more than that, is that we're looking at a figure between 300,000 and 500,000. Can't be more specific than that at the moment. It's subject to confirming what we think of the liabilities, the scale of the liabilities, and to negotiation, as I said. Looking at the bottom half of the slide first, there is a trade-off between what you pay now and what you pay in the future. It's tempting to say, let's get our hands on the club, we'll pay off these creditors over the years. It's attractive, but the problem there is that every year you have to set aside a significant sum to pay all these historical liabilities, and it's hampering your ability to compete on the field because you can't invest it within the playing squad. So there's a great deal to be said for raising the maximum now, discharging all of those liabilities, wiping the slate clean, and knowing that you have the opportunity to invest every last penny that it raised back in the squad and have as good a team as you possibly can to compete out on the field. Moving up the slide slightly, working capital is something that's important. You need cash to play with. The point I made earlier, you do not want to be coming to March and April having to sell the season tickets early just to pay the wages. You do not want to be saying to the commercial manager, go and get us a sponsor for next season's shirt, but don't get the best deal. Get somebody who can pay us before the end of the month because we run out of money. You want to be telling the commercial manager, get the best deal you possibly can, raise the most money, because we've got enough cash flow to see us through to the end of the season without any difficulty. Hopefully there'll be a very small amount for professional fees, but you know, we'll have to get some lawyers involved just to make sure that we know exactly what we're walking into, that there's no hidden liabilities that haven't been appreciated, and there's no skeletons in the cupboard. Moving on to the last slide that I'm going to be dealing with. As I hope I've made clear, it is possible to be run sustainably as long as there's sensible management, sensible decision making. James has touched on the benefits of community ownership. He's got a lot of experience. He's shown you all the clubs that have thrived under community ownership. There's a huge reservoir of goodwill in local communities, I think, for the club that is community owned. And that has benefits both in terms of relationships, commercial relationships with both suppliers and would-be sponsors. Access to volunteer staff, which Jane has touched on, and fundraising generally. Planning is something that's important, and contingency planning. You know, nobody would like me to mention the dreaded word of relegation, but a club that's planned for it, if God forbid it happens, you'd be much better able to cope with it than if you don't see it coming and then have to try and somehow dig yourself out of a hole. So I think that's vital. There's no guarantee of playing success, but if you observe all the sensible procedures, you've got a much better chance of achieving it. You know, lastly, you guys enjoyed 70 years, I think, of league status before, and that's the only reason why you can't enjoy another 70 years, let's hope so.
Obviously as quickly as we can, the key point is our target figure. In fact, I've covered a lot of this, but the money will be held on deposit until you reach that minimum target. If you don't reach the target, the money will be returned. And if we do, the money will be converted into community shares in the trust, which will be held by individuals. The money from the share offer would be used to discharge historical liabilities in the club and provide working capital so the club can operate sustainably and hopefully give a little bank of money that can help you look at potential opportunities to bring in more income. The full share offer, as I say, will include details of the current financial position, financial projections if you become supporter owned, and a bit more information on the potential benefits of the model. Pretty much, I think I covered that whole slide before, but I think it's useful just to go through that and summarise again. Oh, okay. And also, obviously, benefits to individual investors as well. And that's it.
Okay, thanks a lot. Just really to give you an idea of some of the conversations that have been had over the last sort of 4 to 6 weeks in terms of governance and how we envisage it actually functioning. So we've actually consulted with other trusts such as Hart up in Scotland, Wicker, Exeter, and also Wimbledon, just to see about models which we feel we could work and would give us some resilience and robustness to make sure that what we're going to potentially achieve is actually sustainable. And I think key to that is, in terms of sustainability, is we're going to really, if we're successful, live and die by our means to control how we operate financially and operationally and have a proper functional football club. So in light of that, the way we're looking to develop it is a trust board. So the trust board will be essentially the executive, which will be the owners, yourselves, and the representatives of your owners will be the trust board. So at the moment, the way we'd look at that envisioning working would be over the next 3 to 4 months, an interim board committee, which at the moment is the function of people are being colleagues who can't be here, which would then put themselves up for election and be voted on and ratified by yourselves. So you'd be probably pretty pleased to know that none of us consider us to be massive experts of running a football club, so we won't be running the day-to-day operations, you know. We just excite relief there. So the way we see it is there would be an operations board, probably no more than 5 individuals, which would be headed up by the general manager, who started recently, Jason Turner. Also someone representing the finance side as well, so keeping a strong financial control. One trust representative as well, probably also someone with a footballing background and understanding, and maybe a maximum of 1 hour. So we'd see that operational day-to-day board being no more than 5. To encourage and embrace participation, I think also is the method we've developed, which also tries to protect the trust board from doing too much, is individual working groups where all fans can participate and hopefully give their skills to push this forward. So as you can see, example of ways that we're looking at the moment is compliance, commercial finance, community fundraising, fan engagement. Again, we would like to be put on this as well, so if there's any areas that we think we should be covering that we can't, that we don't rather, then feed that back to us and we'll take that on board as we develop these potential working groups. So one of the key ones would be, and following on from Wednesday night, where we look to try and obtain a coalition and backing of all supporter groups, was the fundraising side. So too often I think the club has worked in separate fragmented factions, which has led to perhaps one group organising an event on a Friday night and a different group organising on a Saturday night, and everybody expected to attend both. So the key function of that fundraising, which would be led by the trust board, would be to operate in a far more coordinated manner, make sure they're working together, and also, whilst keeping their autonomy, also work into a business plan. So that could be, as a fundraising group, a target of 25-50k to raise a year, but each individual group within that fundraising working group would be responsible for raising a certain amount of that themselves as well, but working together in a coordinated manner. Also think, just touch on the other side, fan engagement, which we want to obviously encourage a bit more. We're going to be a fully transparent organisation, and part of that will be sharing as much financial information as possible. So the way we look at that working would be quarterly forums, open forums, where we'll share our business plan, where we are, where we're on track, where we're down, where we're up, and full transparency in that area. So obviously wages will be kept out of that, but we feel, as other trusts, with them, check other trusts like Exeter, they'll put the details of their financial results actually on their webpage for anybody to access, as well as their minutes for meetings as well. So we'll be looking to develop the same approach as that. We'd also encourage consultation, feedback, and forums as well. So we've looked at this fan engagement again, led by our executive, but fans are able to take part in that, also to feed in their ideas and suggestions. What we're not saying is that every suggestion will be adopted, but they'll be discussed, developed, and then the lead executive will take that back to the trust board to see if there's any mileage in it going further and introducing it into the football club. So as you can see, what we're trying to develop is a functioning body where the executive is able to make decisions based on planning, strategy, and development. The operational board then is able to actually get on with the day-to-day running. It doesn't have to be tied up with the strategic and business planning side of it. And also there's a mechanism there which really, really encourages involvement and participation from fans. So say again, at the moment it's a working model, and any input over the next few weeks that we get from fans, and indeed certainly offer some help in any of their areas where there's skills, where it's advertising, marketing, would be greatly appreciated. So the answer is, we haven't got all the answers yet, but we feel we've got a functional model which will actually work and progress and is resilient enough to take us through what would be challenging times, but obviously exciting ones as well. Just to make sure you don't go home disappointed, Gavin's made ensure that there's some awful clip art on this slide. So it just underpins our values and belief mechanisms that we'd look to promote for all the dealings that we would carry out with the supporters of the football club. I don't think we can emphasise our commitment too highly to transparency. We'll be open, we'll be honest, and we'll share as much information as possible to you. So if there's a problem, if it looks like we've got issues arising, we'll be transparent in bilateral aid, and you'll be aware of it as soon as we know about it within reason, obviously. Respect for all those groups involved, we really want to look at, we feel that's a specific right for regeneration. And we really think there's an opportunity as a football club to be a real community partner in that and recenter itself in the centre of Newport and as part of that actual regeneration project. So whilst financially we feel there's some challenges, I think there is an exciting opportunity for us to really progress as a football club if we can work together over the short-term financial challenges and put long-term sustainable financial funding models in place. Unity of the different supporters groups, probably maybe one of the hardest activities for the lead executive on that last slide, will be uniting all the fundraising groups and getting them to work together. So I think that's probably one of the most challenging jobs. I also think just because we're emphasising unity, we don't really mean that we should all agree on everything. I think there needs to be a mechanism where we can have a level of dissension, and we can have a level of argument, and we can have a level of challenge, but as long as it actually works towards getting a solution that we all feel that we can work forward and work towards. So I think some of the reality around this diffuses the romanticism of it all. There are going to be tricky times. We're not always going to be loved, probably going to be hated most of the time, but I think we take that on board and we accept that's the way it's going to work. And I think there's nothing wrong with constructive criticism and challenge. I think as a football club, to be honest, we do get a bit oversensitive about that as well. So I think that's one of the things we should probably do, or sort of take on board that there will be dissent, but if it's constructive, I think we can do it. So we'd love to put supporters at the heart of the trust, and I think one area that obviously needs to improve is the timely and regular communication. I think in the last few weeks it's been a bit frustrating that we can't communicate as much as we'd like to, but where we've been able to, we've tried to update you. And I think the website, the whole way we communicate, the timeliness of it and the speed of it, that will be fully and totally looked at and overall. It can't continue with the lack of communication that's gone on in the past, regardless of which way we go.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do we need here, now and in the future? Recognise that part of this process and part of the figure that Nick mentioned earlier is pretty scary for some, so we understand finances and not everybody can donate nearly as much as and contribute as much as others in terms of finance, but there are other ways that it's possible to contribute. So we look for first side, we've just reopened the membership. It's just join the trust. So £10 membership per annum to join the trust, and that gets you one member, one vote. So we have discussions on this. Should we raise it? Should we go to Exeter's at £25? And we thought it was an important principle to keep that open access of one member, one vote, and ability, not based on how much money you've got in your pocket. So we really do want it to be a participatory trust, and we want to encourage people to join wherever their financial circumstances. We're also encouraging, obviously, whilst there's been a level of instability, to say the least, over the last few weeks, and it may have put people off committing to the club and buying tickets and doing this, we do encourage fans to carry on supporting the club while this sort of takeover approach is made. And I think that joining the trust, meeting the manager again, buying a season ticket, and also buying a ticket for the QPR game, I mean, it's really a show of support for what we're doing and the potential viability of it. Is really, there could be no better show really than getting as many people out there supporting it and supporting us at the QPR game on Sunday. So I'd really urge everybody to come out to that and contribute, buy their tickets and season tickets and wherever they can, to just show there's a will and a desire to support what we're doing. Jamie mentioned about the money, pledging money into the holding account. So as we get up and running and look to get the shareholding certification up and running, we'd be looking to actually put some money in a holding account. So none of that money will be spent. If we don't get anywhere near a target that we're working to, that will be returned to everybody. So there's no risk in that until we actually get close to the figure that we need, and then we feel very confident and comfortable with the idea of progressing that. I think it's also important to just give you some background on to how we've come to that figure. Obviously, as the due diligence came on board and looking into the actual finances, we looked at maybe having to make sure that we've got a figure that we can make sure is sustainable through the season. So hence, we probably moved away from a monthly donation approach in the short term towards the share-owning approach, but there will be plans to look at monthly from next season. Not this season, next season. Monthly donations as well for a rewards package as well. So we've been working quite closely with Hearts on this. And just to give you an idea of figures, Hearts, I think in the last year, from supporters, contributed 1.5 million through 8,000 members. What we actually done was have a look. That works out there, £187.50 per head member. So, yeah. Phone call with Hearts and discussed it with them and said, how did that come about? And as you'd imagine, probably 90% of the donations were around about the £10 per month figure, with some of the higher donations and the higher contributors helping it to push it up to an average of £187.50. So in terms of for us to do the same in the future, on a like-for-like basis and a parity basis, it would result in population figures, attendance figures, resulting in 1,600 of our fans contributing £187.50, which would give us an income of and a working capital of £301,000 per year. So, in terms of a sustainable model going forward, that would be something that we'd be certainly looking at. Again, we'd be looking for support and input to that as well, and helping us develop a rewards package so you get something in return for those payments. For instance, the Hearts, you collect points, and when you get to the number of points, you get certain different benefits and rewards and presentations given to you, including your name on the shirt for the coming season as well. So there's a range of things that we'd be looking to do on that, and obviously we need to raise the money first and buy ourselves some time to look at longer, more sustainable funding initiatives. Okay. Sorry, I just think probably touch on the one thing about volunteers as well. Just from a finance perspective, think to us to go forward, we need to get back to volunteering. I think probably as a club, we've probably been a bit complacent over the last few years. I think collectively, we've probably all been guilty of that. And I think that if this is to work, it's not just about the money, it's about the commitment, the time, and the potential of people can volunteer and support the football club.
We can raise enough money through the share offer to satisfy both and our bankable working capital. The governance principles that Sean and quickly laid out are followed, and that ultimately support ownership is embraced and becomes a competitive advantage. It's got the potential to be something that's different, that something that you can cherish. Love, and it's owning your club is a very special thing. So there's a potential that could be an advantage, and I guess that's maybe what's driving people to come here tonight and listen. So I think we'll be opening up to the floor now, John. Who's conducting?